So yeah, module 6, deploying out our application. So now that we have put everything together, it's time to actually get this out there. That, you know, just simply right-clicking, hitting deploy, and doing all that. Okay, that's fine. That works. That's not real world.
Exactly, right? That's developer world.
Yes.
So what we've got, we hit F5, my code is being run on localhost. It's pushing the pieces of the SharePoint app up into the SharePoint site,
yep.
but my code is all still running locally. And that's obviously not how it's going to run in production.
Right.
So why don't we talk a little bit about how to get apps into people's hands?
Yes, let's do that.
Right. So we're going to cover a little bit about app management. We're going to talk about the packaging process and what an app actually looks like. We're going to talk about where you can stick it. So what we're going to do there is we're going to say, how do you get an app into people's hands? And there are a couple of options around that. I think I've managed to break my co-host. As they say, it's... I won't go there. Anyway, right, so publishing apps, where you can put them, how you get them into people's hands, whether that be through the store.
It's getting late.
Or if you want to stick them in an app catalog, we're going to talk about that too, right? And how that gets installed, updated, and a little bit about getting rid of them as well. I broke you. That's awesome. Okay. So, app management. Should we talk about the app catalog?
Yes.
Talk about how to get.
Let's do that.
For most people, getting stuff in an on-prem environment, even in Office 365. Private apps that are going to be used for line of business purposes
right.
aren't going to be distributed widely. They are going to be put in an app catalog.
Exactly, yeah. That the vast majority of the time, I mean, yes, you of course have the ability now to monetize your apps and do so relatively easily, but the vast majority of what you're going to be building on a day-to-day basis, if you will, is going to be something that's going to be developed for in-house, local use, and not something that's going to be published out to the outside world. So you do have the capability to publish it out to the marketplace, but don't think just because you hear the word app that, oh my gosh, this has to go into the marketplace, that everybody has to be able to access this.
Yeah.
We can just deploy this straight out to the local app catalog.
Right, and so you can create, you know, you can create an app catalog on-prem, on-premises, but that's not quite all there is to it in terms of getting apps into people's hands on-prem.
Right.
In the cloud, this is a bunch easier because a lot of this work is done for you. Whereas on-prem, you've got to do a little bit of legwork to get apps working.
Exactly, yeah. And so the slide calls out a little bit of this, that you'll notice that we do need the app management service. You'll notice that we do need the site subscription service for tenancy capabilities. These do need to be set up. And actually, even this slide doesn't necessarily call out everything that needs to be done, because I will need to go into DNS and update a couple of things inside of DNS to allow for hosting of my apps. Then in particular, I'm going to need an asterisk entry for that particular domain, because after all, every time we install that app again, we're going to get another URL, another URL, another URL. So we need to make sure that all of that's going to work. So there's some work that needs to be done here. There's some work that needs to be done inside of DNS. And this will take a little bit of work by the administrator.
Yeah, so it's definitely an IT pro task. And there's PowerShell scripts. A little bit of that you can see here, some samples.
Yep.
But you can go and grab all those from MSDN and then sort of via way of bribery or sugar, go and talk to your friendly IT pro to get the app infrastructure piece set up on-prem.
Exactly.
But like I said, a lot of this is all done, obviously, all done for you in Office 365, so you don't need to do any of this sort of heavy lifting.
Yep, exactly.
In terms of where you can put your app, we talked about the store. Now, that's going to be global, so there are some controls around this. So on a tenant-by-tenant basis, we'll take a look at the tenancy settings in a second, but a tenant admin can configure whether they want to allow people to add apps to their sites and so forth, so there still is some control. But when an app is put in the store, it goes through the same sort of submission processes as phone applications do. There's a set of rules you've got to stick by. There's some things you can and you can't do and so forth as part of that submission process. But once it's in the store, the idea is that anybody can go and grab it and install it on their site.
Right.
So there isn't any sort of permissioning at that level to say only these three or four people get access to the app. For that, you want to sideload or put your app in an app catalog. And so you can go set one of those up. drop in your application package and then make it available to sites that want to install that app. Also, it's worth noting that administrators can push apps out into sites as well, sort of standard apps that you might create for your organization, or maybe it's a project management app or an invoicing app or something like that, and you can bulk push them out into a bunch of different sites.
Yep.
So why don't we talk a little bit about the what goes into a package first, and then that might help folks understand exactly what it is we mean by deploying an app.
Absolutely. So one of the big things to keep in mind, if you want to kick over to the next slide here, and I really want to dive straight for that that third and fourth bullet point, is the app web solution and the host web features. That, again, if you've done any form of SharePoint development in the past, this really does extend on what we've already done. So there is still going to be a solution that all of the little templates that I had built up, that page that I had built up in my earlier demo, that does need to be deployed out, and all of that's still going to be inside of essentially a classic solution with classic features and be added into SharePoint that way. And then, of course, up above, we have the couple of items that are going to be specific to being an app. So we've got the app icon, which you'll notice that you get just that little generic crossed box there. Not really a good way to do things. So you will want to make sure that you do set up your own icon. And you'll notice the default name there is app icon PNG. You can go in and set that up. And then you'll also notice the manifest. And the manifest is going to not only be your typical package manifest where it's going to say, hey, this is what I'm now giving you, but it's also going to have the list of everything that it's trying to do. So if it does need any special permissions like write access to lists, that the manifest will contain all that information.
Gotcha. Yeah, that's really important. Now, it's also important to note that on each different type of app that we've talked about, you know, some of these components are in there and some of them aren't, depending on the type.
Exactly.
So the big one, obviously, is the difference between SharePoint and auto-hosted apps versus provider-hosted. Obviously, the list is a lot longer for those first two than the third.
Right.
So in the provider-hosted app package, really all you've got is the app manifest plus any things that need to go in the app web.
Right.
But none of your code sits in there. That gets deployed off into Azure separately.
Whereas or wherever it is that you're hosting it.
Wherever you're hosting it. Yeah, exactly. Whereas the auto-hosted app contains a whole bunch more things, including the web project that ends up being deployed into Azure, as well as a DAC pack for SQL if you want to attach or install a database as part of your app.
Right, because remember again, with that provider hosted, it's got to create the web, it's got to create your database, so all of that needs to be inside that package.
Right, so where in a provider hosted app you'd push that web deployment package out to Azure yourself, in an auto hosted app it's all bundled into that same project.
Yep.
Or into that same file, I should say.
Yep.
And then a SharePoint hosted app is slightly simpler, in that it's all declarative and there's just assets in there. There's no code-based project deployed as part of that. So publishing. There's a few different steps to this, right? There's first, how do you get it out of Visual Studio? Then it's how do you get it into people's hands?
Right. And getting it out of Visual Studio, this is one of the nice little things in Visual Studio, not just for apps, but as we talked about earlier when we were doing our sandbox solution, is we've now got the ability just to simply right-click and say publish. And instead of just it going, oh, okay, well, now I'm going to deploy that out to Visual Studio, we get to choose where it is that we want to send it out to. So if we kick over to the slide here, what you're going to notice is that we get to specify where it is that that we want to be able to send this out to. So, you know, where is our website hosted, and then the ID for our client, our certificate, and then the issuer. You've got all your information there.
Yeah, and so what we're going to do is show, when we jump into the demo, I'm going to show where you get your client ID and secret from when you want to publish, because you can't create those yourself if you're going to publish them to the store.
Right.
So I'll show you how to do that as we jump to the demo. In terms of the store, there are obviously some additional requirements and hoops you have to jump through to get into the store. First up, you've got to have a seller dashboard account. You can go and create one of those for free up front just to get registered. But if you want to submit apps, you've got to end up going through the process and registering, sort of, and being vetted a little more thoroughly. But again, it's that global location where apps for not only SharePoint, but Office can go as well. So if you want to go up, take a Bing for Office Store, and you'll find it up on office.com, and you can go and say, show me all the SharePoint apps. And you'll get a catalog of those, and you can see what's available up there for SharePoint. Like I said, dashboard, seller dashboard account is required to do this, and I'll show you what that looks like in a moment. And then you have to provide some information, screenshots, description, title, all of the standard sort of stuff, basically for that catalog site. Then Microsoft go away and test your app, and they basically install it and run it and put it through a whole bunch of checks and balances. They run some code analysis on it, that sort of stuff, and make sure that it's all quality stuff and that you're not doing anything naughty before they let you publish it. Getting it into an app catalog is obviously slightly simpler in that you're not having to go through Microsoft as part of that process. So you can simply create your app catalog site, go into Central Admin and do that, or into Tenant Admin in Office 365, upload your app package, and show and add in the details for that app, like the title and description and so forth.
Yep.
So why don't we go take a quick look at those two things?
Let's do that.
All right. So we can just jump to demo.
Jump to conclusions?
Not just yet.
Okay. All right.
Soon.
Okay. Well, Office Space reference.
Oh, I'm not up to speed, obviously.
Oh, that's a must-see. That's one of those geek movies that, everybody needs to see.
So I hear. I'm missing out. Okay, so I'm back in my Office 365 tenancy here. Let me just make sure we're all refreshed and logged in and all that goodness. And first, let's look at an app catalog.
Okay.
So I'm in an Office 365 tenancy here, but you can do the same thing on-prem. It's slightly different in terms of how you get into the app catalog and create the app catalog and so forth, but for all intents and purposes, it's the same sort of functionality. So I'm going to jump into Tenant Admin for SharePoint. And again, you have to be a tenant administrator to get into this location. And down on the left-hand side here, you can see apps in the sidebar here. And that's basically the entry point to all things apps at a tenancy level. So let's click into that. And now you can see I've got a few different apps for managing licenses for apps that I've bought from the store. I could configure the store settings about whether I want to let people download stuff from the store or not at a tenant level. I can look at apps that I've got installed and monitor them. I can see what permissions they've got into various places in the tenancy and so forth. But the top one up here is the app catalog. And so by default, when you click this, and you haven't created an app catalog, it'll step you through a wizard to create one.
Okay.
And so what happens when you're done with that is in your site collections, you'll see an app catalog site. Here it is. This is the one I created earlier, Sites Whack App Catalog. And after you've created it, when you click on that app catalog link, it'll take you directly to it. And so here, it's just like it's a site, but you've got, information about the apps that have been requested or apps that have been loaded into your app catalog. So if I click on apps for SharePoint, you'll see I've got an app here, Nintex Forms for Office 365. I was part of the test program and loaded it into my app catalog. I sideloaded it. Now it's going to be available through the store. So this is not a great example, but you'd take your app package and drop it up in here. And so the way you do that is you simply click New Application. You get to pick a file, and then you fill out a form. You basically say, here's the title, here's the description, go. Much like a list form, it'll pop it into this list, and away you go. Now, it's slightly different if you want to get it into the Office store.
Well, yeah.
So I mentioned the seller dashboard. Now, I've signed up for an account and have a seller dashboard account that I'm showing up on the screen now. There's really two parts to this. There's the client ID section and adding an app. Now, the client ID section, that's where you go if you want to get IDs and secrets for apps. So the way it works is you can say, when you're developing your application, you can say, I want to build a provider-hosted app that I'm going to provide through the store for folks. And so as part of that, you need to go and get an ID and a secret for that application to facilitate the OAuth between those two halves of your application. So that your back end of your app can reach into SharePoint. And so if you put it in the store, you need an ID and a secret from the store itself. And so the way you do that is you sign up for a seller dashboard account, You jump into client IDs, and here you can say, I want to add a new OAuth client ID in secret. And so you come in here, you give it a friendly name, you say, what domain is my app going to be hosted on?
Mm-hmm.
So whether it'll be something like myawesomeapp.azurewebsites.net or something like that, or a friendlier name.
Sure.
The app redirect URL, so this is what happens when somebody wants to, when the app requests permissions, where it's going to redirect after the OAuth flow is complete, how long it's valid for, and whether it's going to be available worldwide or just in China. Then you can generate a client ID. That will give you an ID and a secret that you can then put into your web config file or stick in through the publishing process in Visual Studio. And it'll put it into your app manifest, it'll put it into your web config. Everything's groovy.
Awesome.
Then once you've done that, and you've built your app, you've tested it, you've put it up in your 365 tenant, you've made it sure it's all cool, You can submit it to the store. And so you do that through the Manage tab. So when you come in and say, add a new app, you select the type of it, you say, I've got an app for SharePoint, or an app for Outlook, or an app for Office, and you click Next. Then you fill out the same sort of details, you give it, you know, the logo, you upload your app package with it as well.
Mm-hmm.
And then any notes for Microsoft and so forth. There are additional steps of this wizard, including a step that says, do you want this to be a free app? How do you want to license this app? That you also get to fill out. How much will it cost per seat? That sort of thing.
Right.
So that's how you'd get the app in the store. Once you're done, you hit submit, goes through all the submission process. Once it's all live and groovy, then you can jump back into your SharePoint site and start adding the apps through from the store. I don't know if we should show that. It's kind of much like an app store from other locations.
Yep. So I personally just love seeing my trips up there. So
that's a personal thing of mine, personal project that I've been working on. I make the app for Windows Phone.
No kidding.
Yeah.
So I swear to you, this is 100% unscripted. I actually had no idea. I love that app.
Thank you.
I have that on my phone. I should buy you coffee. I love that application.
Yeah, so even though my screenshot in the demo showed MyTrips, I am not building a MyTrips for Office 365 just yet.
Just yet.
It was the thing I was playing around with.
Okay.
But go get it for Windows Phone and Windows 8.
Yes, it's a fantastic tool. It really is. All right, let's close this back out with doing installation, upgrading, and deleting. So if you want to just fire back up the slides over there.
Yep. Let me flip over here.
That's cool. That's you. All right. So
small world.
Yeah. Let's go ahead and first start off with app installation. We've already walked through the process of doing the installation in the whole nine yards. The one thing that is worth highlighting, though, on this slide is the fact that with basically everything in SharePoint, it is available through PowerShell. So if you want to automate the installation deployment of apps, it is possible to do that through PowerShell. Okay. Now, as far as doing an upgrade, here's the biggest thing about an upgrade. You're going to notice that your upgrades are based on the version number that's inside the app manifest. All upgrades are voluntary, are optional. They are not mandatory. There's no way that you can force somebody into a new version. Mm. Now, when you're talking about SharePoint and auto-hosted apps, these are easy because the SharePoint-hosted app, that's just the JavaScript. That's it. And your little app.
Talking about SharePoint hosted apps?
SharePoint hosted.
Yes, you said auto hosted.
Did I?
Yeah.
Okay, sorry. SharePoint hosted apps. Thank you. My SharePoint hosted apps are just the app web, the JavaScript, and that's it. There's really nothing else that's there. Yep. So when somebody upgrades, that's the only component that's going to be upgraded. When we're talking about auto hosted apps, yeah, there's going to be an app web potentially and the client side code, just like with the SharePoint hosted app. But in particular, with an auto hosted app, we are going to have that little environment that's been created off to the side with our database and everything else. All of those are just upgraded as one unit. Remote hosted apps are
slightly different.
Yeah. That's going to be the problem.
So if you put an app in the store and lots of people are using it, then once it's been installed into a whole lot of different sites and tenancies and that sort of thing, then if you're doing a provider or a remote hosted app, you've only got one back end, right? So you have to consider what happens when half of those tenancies have upgraded to the new version.
Right.
You have to, your back end of the app has to be able to deal with support for both of those versions. And so there's some techniques you can use for doing that on the back end, like detecting the version of the app that's being launched and so forth, or providing different views and things like that for V1 versus V2 and stuff like that. But the important part is that you need to keep a track of who's using what versions of your apps. Monitor in the back end of your app as one version starts lowering in usage, as people are upgrading to the other version, that you can't drop support for the previous version until that's down to zero.
Right.
And you, then you can tidy up the back end of your app and get rid of the support for V1.
Yep. And then finally, last but not least, is deleting the app. And as Chris mentioned earlier, when it comes to deleting an app, if it's a SharePoint hosted app, all you're going to do is basically just delete the app web and away that goes. And that's going to be true for your provider hosted as well as your auto hosted apps as well. That anything that's inside the app web, that goes. But anything that's on the server, that's going to stay behind. So that way, if there is some data that's there that we want to make sure that we still had available in case of like an accidental deletion or the like, if we keep it separate from SharePoint, if we keep it out of the app web, all of that's still going to be safe.
Yeah, so if you want to have persistent data that stays around after a deletion,
yep,
you've either got to have a provider-hosted app with some sort of database that's keeping it all in the back, or put it in the host web.
Yep. All right. So what we saw here is how to take the app that we've been working on and how to actually send that out to a to the
app
marketplace
catalog.
Or to an app catalog. So what do you say we take a little break?
Sure.
And then we can come on back and we'll close everything off with workflows.
Sounds great.
Excellent.